Welcome again to Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown, and joining me today is Karen Russell to talk about her novel Swamplandia. It is about the Bigtree family that runs an amusement park in the Florida Everglades, but it is not a Disney-style amusement park. This is about alligator wrestling is one of the major draws, and it's certainly not an average family. The book focuses on the three children, 13-year-old Ava, right? Ava, yeah. Her older sister Ossie, who is communing and romancing ghosts, and I think we'll explain, and their brother Kiwi, who escapes to the mainland but ends up in his own world of darkness, so to speak. Welcome to you.
Thank you.
Now, this is a wonderful mix of high literature, fantasy, coming of age. Tell me what you thought you were writing here.
You know, I grew up reading a lot of these super weird genre bending, you know, Southern Gothic writers.
So Southern Gothic, huh?
I think I thought of it sort of as a mashup, that I really wanted it to be a suspenseful story, but I'm always sort of interested in you know, flowering up the language. So
you like the idea of mixing the genres?
I think so, yeah. I really wanted it to have kind of a Huck Finn on the river underworld tale, which I guess says that's a lot mashed
I guess
in
so. But
already.
So were there, there were models like that, Huck Finn and other models?
I don't know that I could think of a model for this, what happened with this particular book. But I do love a book that was a huge influence on me was Catherine Dunn's Geek Love, which also tells the tale of this sort of carnival family where all kinds of weird domestic rites are inverted. They have this sort of fabulous a family of freaks. So I think that was one proto model.
Family of freaks. You're from Southern Florida. This takes place in another part of Southern Florida. Is there any?
I like to say a mythic Florida to avoid litigation. I like to say like a fictional.
Good idea. But where did the
Florida.
Idea? Where did it come from? Because it's not your background.
Well, my own family is very clear about me, you know, going on air and saying that it's not a memoir. So it's, they're kind, sane people. Uh-huh. I grew up sort of going to more malls than wrestling alligators. But it is sort of the fictionalized version of my home. I mean, we did live about an hour from the Everglades, and I always thought that was the most alien, fantastic place on the planet. So I think probably more so than any literature, the model is this geologic, ancient, you know, swamp in our backyard was probably the model for this thing.
It's interesting you mentioned Huck Finn. There's at its heart, it's a sort of story of lost children. Right, the mother dies early on, even though she's a heroic figure, an alligator, champion alligator wrestler. The father can't deal with what's happening, and then it's about children.
I think that is expedient for narrative purposes to get those authority figures out of the way. I don't think, you know, what if they had really protective, you know, authoritarian parents? Nothing would happen in the book. It would just, they would all apply for college and go off. I mean, I do, joking aside, think that it's those pockets of neglect where really interesting things start to happen for children often. It's when they're not being, you know, they're not under anyone's surveillance. And the swamp is a scary place to be alone, so.
And part of it is narrated by 13-year-old Ava.
Nice.
And the other is the story of the brother, told in the third person, which I thought was interesting.
Mm-hmm. You know, I tried that in the first person at one point, and it just felt too close to Ava's voice. Mm-hmm. And then also that section I sort of thought as like the, If you think of it as like a musical or something, Ava's story is the much more serious, nightmarish one, and his is kind of the comic relief story. And it felt sort of like third person to get this sort of a much larger world and have a satirical view. I thought that was the way to go.
And, you know, thinking again about the genre mixing, because there's parts of it that are about ecology, about the local history. Mm. Must have taken some research as well, right?
Yeah, it did. This was different for me because I had a collection of short stories come out. And all the research I did for that was just, you know, in my own crazy brain or like really lazy Google searches. So it was different to really read some first-person accounts of, they had these dredgemen that sort of had the insane project of draining the swamp. There was a lot that I didn't know. I read about the Indian Wars. I had sort of always thought that the Seminole Indians were our indigenous Indians, meaning that they had been there since time immemorial. Somehow, you know, in our school, we weren't given the information that they were chased down there from Georgia during the Indian Wars. So all of this was interesting to me. As a resident of Florida, I hadn't known any of it.
Now, you mentioned the short story collection. This grew out of a short story, right?
Mm-hmm, it did. These people have been around for the majority of my 20s. I, like, couldn't shake them. It's so nice that the book is published, and now I can move on from the swamp.
But before you move on, though, tell me, did you always conceive that there was a novel here, or did you wrote the short story first and then later time think, I got to stay with these people?
I think I was writing these stories in graduate school, and I had this one, the Ava Russell's The Alligator story. Mm-hmm. All of the other stories I'd been content to sort of say, check please, you know, and move on. And I just felt very haunted by those characters. And it had never really quite been a short story. It had always been this giant, sort of like a swamp, this big sprawl. You know, I had generated all of this material about this place, Swamplandia, mm-hmm. And just couldn't stop thinking about it. And
you cut it way down to make the short story?
Well, yeah, it's been like playing an accordion to write this thing, because I cut it way down to do the short story. We did sort of like an ice cream scoop of the most dramatic part. And then, but I still had so much material, and all the characters felt really alive to me and really in trouble. The short story ends where these two sisters are just alone in the swamp with all of this danger humming around them. So it seemed sort of cruel to leave them there. It seemed like there was sort of had the DNA of a longer.
Well, this is a first novel, though. So what were the challenges or difficulties of building something that brought
making it huge again? It was sort of like, I think everyone uses that sprint to marathon analogy, mm-hmm. but it did feel a little bit like that. I sort of think it would be like if you were just singing in the shower or something, and then someone was like, now do it for 3 hours in front of all these people, you know? And so that was challenging, to kind of sustain the world and the energy of the world over time, and to have multiple worlds going. I thought one of the big challenges of the book is that I really wanted it to be about sort of a portrait of the Everglades, but also kind of contemporary South Florida. So it wasn't just going to be the micro society of one family. There was going to be this macro view that the brother gives you. But that, you know, that looks so beautiful visually in my head, and then trying to get all of those.
You mean to turn it into the storytelling aspect of it at length?
To do it at length, and to have sort of multiple worlds going at once. So to have Ava's world, mm-hmm. which is sort of lush and dreamy and weird and takes place.
And that's the magical part of, well.
Not
exactly.
I think that's sort of the more fantastical part.
Yeah.
And then Kiwi's world is more sort of like the hell we all recognize. It's just the hell of like being an adolescent.
Yeah.
You know,
working a dead-end job.
And, you know, going to night school. So that's a more familiar hell, I think, to most readers.
One of the, I told you before we started that I read about this and then put it aside, and then only recently came back to it and sort of forgotten what I was getting into.
I did that a few times myself.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Right.
But I was interested because then I was looking at some reviews last night, and one said that you have style in spades. And I thought, that's for sure. I mean, style in spades. But I wonder, do you have to worry about the style getting in the way almost or overpowering the story because you do have you do have style in spades.
I sort of love that blurb only because in actual life, in like fashion terms, I'm always like wearing overalls or something. So it's nice. That was a particularly nice one, I thought. I am really conscious of that. And with the story to novel transition, one of the things that was a new challenge was thinking about how to keep the momentum of a plot moving forward and not embroidering, you know, every single bush or something. But I've always sort of
because
loved,
it could, I mean, embroidering, it could become too poetic, it could become too cute at times,
right.
When you're in that childish voice or the adolescent voice.
I think that's very, and I mean, you know, Lord knows that's still a challenge for me, is you don't want it to become too precious or too knowing. And then readers want to know what's going to happen. So, you know, that's always a struggle for me, is to balance your own pleasure as a writer, saying, look at those clouds, here's 14 analogies for them, and sort of also saying, you know, there's real suspense pushing you.
Mm-hmm.
But I have to say, you know, my own authors are always tend to be the ones, you know, Virginia Woolf or Joy Williams or folks who really do pay a lot of attention on the sentence level. I never was a big, you know, Carver minimalist.
So you worry about it, but not over worry.
I worry about it, but I think I know, too, that I'm never going to, you know, have sort of spare, deadpan. There's probably always going to be like some monkey jimmying around in the background.
Well, so have you put these people behind you now? What is next?
Yes, isn't that great? I'm so happy that they're out in the world. I can't even tell you. I'm so happy that readers have access to them now, and they made it out of that swamp of my mind.
What are you
writing on? My sister says it's a total overcorrection for this book. It's a second novel set during the Dust Bowl drought.
Oh.
I know. She says I should call it Drylandia. That's her big joke.
With a question mark this time?
Yeah, exactly.
All right. Well, this book is called Swamplandia with an exclamation point. Karen Russell, nice to talk to you.
Yeah, really nice to talk to you.
Okay.
Thanks.
And thank you for joining us again on Artbeat. I'm Jeffrey Brown.